Now they want it 5 minutes. Then they want to go on impromptu speech to run for 2 minutes with 5 minutes preparation. The first speaker is Sarah Donaldson, speaking on amnesty.
6 years, 4 months, 17 days in prison, I'm free. I walked out of the prison gate with my shoulders unbent, my head unbowed. I can touch the green leaves of the trees. I can smell the sweet scent of flowers. I can share smiles and laughter with the women and children. Surely there is nothing so sweet, so beautiful, so precious as freedom and liberty. Professor Maina Wa Kenyatta, former prisoner of conscience, Kenya. Today, thousands of people are imprisoned for their beliefs. Many are held without charge or trial. Torture and the death penalty are widespread. In many countries, men, women and children have disappeared after being taken into official custody. Still others have been killed without any pretense of legality. These human rights abuses occur in countries of widely differing ideologies. Amnesty International is an independent, non-religious, worldwide movement of more than 1.1 million people in over 150 countries, acting on the conviction that governments must not deny individuals their basic human rights. Amnesty works specifically and impartially for the release of prisoners of conscience, men, women and children imprisoned for their beliefs, colour, sex, ethnic origin, language or religion, provided they have not used or advocated violence, for fair and prompt trials for all political prisoners, an end to torture, executions and disappearances in all cases, and any other cruel, inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. Last June, in the southeast Mexican state of Chiapas, three young indigenous women were returning to their village after selling produce at a market. At a roadblock, they were raped by 10 soldiers and told that they would be killed if they told anyone. Of the conflict in former Yugoslavia, there have been several reliable reports of public rapes in front of a whole village, designed to terrorise the population and force ethnic groups to flee. In some countries, like Sudan and Iran, hundreds of women have been flogged for breaching dress laws. Wearing clothing contrary to public decency is punishable by up to 40 lashes. José Silva, a Portuguese schoolboy, was arrested in 1965, along with 16 other schoolboys and girls during student demonstrations. José was 15 years old. That's like me, just being arrested. Because he was under 16, he was sent to a home for juvenile delinquents, where it was reported he was to be detained until his 16th birthday, when he could be transferred to prison. He was not charged with any offence, and his mother was only allowed to see him once a fortnight. In Bangladesh, some local village councils controlled by Islamists have set themselves up as enforcers of their interpretation of Islamic law. These councils, known as Salish, which are not part of the judicial system and have no legal authority, have, in the past 3 months, ordered the execution, torture, or ill treatment of women. A Salish sentenced a girl to a public whipping in May 1994. The girl had been raped about 8 months earlier and had become pregnant. The alleged rapist had been acquitted by the Salish because the crime was not witnessed by four Muslim adult males of good repute, as was required by Islamic law. When her pregnancy was discovered, she was declared guilty of illicit sexual intercourse and sentenced to be publicly flogged 101 times. She was 13 years old. But possibly most frightening of all are the disappearances. Imagine your father going off to work and just never coming home, just disappearing. Imagine wondering where he was, if he was in pain, if he was dead, and probably in a couple of years discovering his battered and emaciated body naked in a dump somewhere. This happens right now, as I speak, to real flesh and blood people with a heart and a liver and toenails and a dog and a favourite type of music and a life. And that scares me. It scares me that people can be so inhuman as to inflict such horrible pain on another person. And it doesn't just happen that far away from home. A New South Wales study shows that not one Aboriginal family living in the state in the early 1980s had escaped having children taken and put into institutions. Not one. But in the words of Martin Luther King, The ultimate tragedy is not the brutality of bad people, but the silence of good people. Great wonders are possible if little groups just try to stay faithful to what they believe to be true and just. Amnesty International, through letters, fights for this justice, for the simple human rights of every person. And it works. More than one person has shared the experience of the man in Central America who was told on his release, "You would be dead if so many people didn't know about you." Another former prisoner writes, "For years I was held in a tiny cell. My only human contact was with my torturers. My only company was cockroaches and mice. For 8 months I had my hands and feet tied. On Christmas Eve, the door to my cell opened and the guard tossed in a crumpled piece of paper. It said simply, 'Constantino, do not be discouraged. We know you are alive.' It was signed Monica and had the Amnesty International candle on it. Those words saved my life and my sanity. 8 months later, I was set free." It is this way, says the Turkish poet Nazım Hikmet, being captured is beside the point. The point is not to surrender. Or as Midnight Oil put it, it is better to die on your feet than to live on your knees. But I always wonder, when the crunch came, would I have the strength to stand? My greatest admiration to those with such integrity, to those who have been silenced, and to those who speak for them. Iranian poet and playwright Saeed Soltanpour was imprisoned many times for his writings under the Shah, and then arrested by the new Islamic government and executed after accusing the authorities of torturing people and suppressing freedom. He writes, "Upon this plain of blood roses and iron stalks, I will not stay silent. So hear my voice as it sings in the slaughterhouse."
Back to people and places.
For some strange and unknown reason, parents insist on taking their children to visit friends and relatives of theirs who are among the most boring people the human race has ever produced. What is worse, parents insist during these visits that their children A, dress in smart, uncomfortable clothes, and B, remain silent, with only the occasional spot of quiet breathing allowed. It has always struck me that this is the perfect example of the hypocrisy of parents. They spend years teaching their children to walk and talk, and as soon as they can, they tell them to sit down and to be quiet. Why do parents insist on taking their children? When their child complains, parents say, "If you don't be quiet, we'll leave you here and go without you." When the child says, "Good, that's what I want," the parents ignore this remark and force their offspring into hideous clothes and bundle them into the nearest form of transport and force them to endure mind-numbing boredom for what seems like two eternities. If this sounds like something that has happened to you, this is how to get out of it. This is how to make sure, after one visit, you are never invited back again. A. Break things. Aim for something irreplaceable, like an heirloom that has been in the family for generations. If there are none lying around, aim for something expensive, but remember to apologise afterwards. "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realise it was there." This will make it impossible for the awful friend or relative to ask your parents to pay for it. On the other hand, if they do have to pay for it, it serves the same purpose. They won't let you back again. There are plenty of things you can dismantle with one sharp pull. For all of them, you can use the same excuse. It came off in my hand. Useful targets include door handles, doorbells, toilet roll handles, handles off cups, and whiskers off ornamental animals. B. Ruin furniture. Stick the following on your host's furniture: food, vomit, snot, chewing gum, drink, dirty soled shoes. Drop any of these on the cloth-covered furniture. Once your chosen substance has hit the material, smear it in to make it permanent. C. Food. Eat disgustingly. Keep your mouth open at all times and make sure it is always cramped full to overflowing. Talk to people as you eat. Spray food with every word. Talk to more people. Talk to lots of people while eating. It sprays the food in more directions. Choke on your food. Go purple in the face. Clutch your throat. Or don't eat any food at all. This always offends someone who has spent hours in the kitchen preparing it. Pull funny faces as you eat to let everyone know that you think the food is disgusting. And say things like, gee, I guess the food isn't as bad as what Mum and Dad said it would be. D. Criticise the house. You can do this directly or subtly. The direct ways are, don't you ever clean this house? These chairs look a bit cheap. Do we have to drink out of these cups? Then there is the more subtle way. I know the name of a good window cleaner if you'd like it. I expect it must be lots of fun getting your furniture from garage sales. And last but not least, E. Indulge in embarrassing topics of conversation. My grandpa suffers from piles. He has to sit on a rubber cushion with a hole in the middle. Did you hear? My cat's got diarrhea. Oh, Mum, how much longer do we have to stay here? I thought we might have to eat out of a trough because Mum and Dad said you eat like pigs here, and so on. If the host has ice cream, sneak into the kitchen and eat it. If they have a bowl of lollies, eat the lollies as well. Make rude noises as you eat, as if you were suffering from wind, and make sure to never say please and thank you. If you follow this excellent advice, you'll soon be sitting at home, feet on the sofa, watching your favourite TV program in peace. In fact, doing what you want for a change.
Drugs and drug abuse.
Speak on drugs and drug abuse. For those who don't know, a drug can be a natural or chemical substance which can be harmful to the body, causing side effects and mental problems. There are many types of drugs such as marijuana, weed or gummy, acid or chips, cocaine, heroin and ecstasy. These are just a few of the more commonly heard of drugs. All these drugs, excluding marijuana, are chemical drugs. These are made in illegal laboratories and are sold on the street. These drugs come in the form of powder, liquid or tablet, and can be consumed through mouth, snorted or injected. Marijuana, on the other hand, is a natural drug. It is a plant. Various parts of the plant are dried and then mulled and or compressed and smoked. This is grown and also sold on the street. All of these drugs I have mentioned have many side effects. A few of them are drowsiness, tiredness, headaches, nausea, unexplained hunger fits, hallucinations, and many more. All these drugs are addictive and dangerous. Although many people say marijuana isn't, they are actually quite dangerous. Yeah, maybe it seems that it does nothing unless you are a heavy smoker. In some instances this may be true, but after a while, it takes more and more to take effect. The smoker then begins to look for something heavier, something stronger. And sooner or later, they end up overdosing on drugs. And this is called drug abuse. Although it seems that drug abuse hardly ever happens, it really does. The reason we don't hear about it as often as what it does happen is because there are more important things to show on the news. But as it is not realised, people die every day as a result of drug abuse. Just recently, a young girl, the same age as us, died of an overdose on ecstasy. And it was said that she was a first-time user. But what about the actual addicts? Many of our famous role models have also died using chemical drugs, such as River Phoenix and Jim Morrison, just to name a couple. They say that the deaths were caused by drug-induced heart failure. The stereotypical image of a drug user is Aboriginal, famous, or on the dole and doesn't lift a finger. But what happens when the source runs out? They get unreasonable, and then they begin to steal to support their habit. And this ends up with the police involved. Others deal drugs for a bit of extra cash and to make quite a large profit in the process. I wonder if the dealers have ever thought that they are contributing to most of the teenage deaths in the world. Although it's not heard of very often, it does happen, more than we realise. And yet again, some still insist that marijuana is harmless and should be legalised. After all, it has happened. With people dying from overdoses, allergic reactions and drug-induced heart failure, they still think that natural drugs should be legalised. Maybe they feel by doing this, They will drive the younger generations away from the drugs, but I think this will only turn the users to harder drugs, for the simple fact that they aren't allowed to do it by law and it's rebellious. I think that it will be at least a decade before drugs are legalised, because they haven't found a way to tax the drug, and if the government can't make money out of it, why would they legalise it? Everyone knows that the government doesn't do anything unless they benefit from them themselves. And another reason is because the police cannot detect any drug without a blood test. And because they affect your reactions, they need some way to detect if people are driving under the influence, in the same way they do with alcohol. Thanks for listening.
Teachers and Year 10 students, my topic is on abuse to children, women, men and the elderly, and what harm it can do to the victim. The sort of treatment that is suffered by, this sort of treatment is suffered by a very high percentage of people, such as women and children, etc. This is something that is wrong, and through this people can be seriously hurt. Some examples of this treatment are as follows. Just yesterday from the Telegraph Mirror, a young gay man, aged 27, was walking down the streets of Taylor Square in Sydney. He was brutally bashed almost to death, and he's now on life support. This was done by a bunch of youths who wanted what? A measly bit of money. Come on. Another incident, also in the Telegraph Mirror on Monday, said the 21-year-old man was bashed, robbed, and left laying in a pool of blood outside of a motel in Goulburn. This is just 60 minutes away from where we live. What is this place coming to? It makes you want to go home, lock every door and window, and only come out during the day. Another article I read was on a female shopkeeper. Four men bashed her after entering the shop in Rush Cutters Bay. They punched her several times before escaping with a small amount of money. Also, this man had a knife, wore a blue tracksuit, and had a dark complexion, so if anybody sees him, ring the police. The matter that should have been on the front page of the paper was wife killer insane. A survivor of the Tynanian massacre was insane when he decapitated his wife's head and threw it down the toilet. He then put the rest of her body in the bathtub. This man, Mr. Li Ning, was not put in jail but only in a psychiatric hospital. Where's the justice? A woman loses her life, but it's all right because Mr. Ning's a psycho. People are getting so desperate it's come to the stage where people as young as 16 have to rob people, bash people and kill people because they don't find anything else to do. Daniel Godley, 19, was at a wedding when he left with his girlfriend in a taxi. From drinking so much, he dropped the keys out the window and then asked the taxi driver to stop. He told the others then to go on and he'd look for him and catch up with them later. After realising he'd left his wallet in the taxi, he forced a lady to the ground, scared her and took off with the car. Less than 10 minutes later, he was dead from running a red light. This lady now, that was forced to the ground, has to live with the fact that if she was a few minutes earlier, a few minutes later, this might not have happened at all. See, people once again are getting to the stage where they're getting desperate. This isn't just endangering the victim, but they're also endangering their lives as well. The most famous example I have on this kind of treatment is the biggest one all over the world, the O.J. Simpson trial. O.J. was married with children and he used to hit his wife quite a bit. Then one day, Nicole, his wife, and her male friend were found dead. This trial went on for over a year. With more evidence you could poke a stick at, it was pretty obvious that O.J. killed him, but did he? O.J. was found not guilty of murder, and the killer and the killer still runs free. Only 14 days ago, a young teenage youth was at a party. She had quite a bit to drink and could hardly walk. When she was taken home and put into bed, 15 minutes later she awoke and got up. When grabbing a knife and climbing out the window, she crossed the road and stabbed a poor innocent 14-year-old girl that was sitting on her front doorstep. How would you feel if it was your daughter stabbed? The most common cause of abuse is alcohol and drugs. And unless you do it, the less this treatment will occur. We should and do live in a society that gives everybody the chance and a decent life. So out of a situation like this, it makes everybody aware of what's going on, and hopefully in the future this kind of treatment will decrease. Thank you.
And all the moments and problems that stick out in my mind. My name, it's not very hard. In total, it only has 5 syllables. It really seems incredible to me that in our increasingly multicultural society, people find it difficult to pronounce. I mean, you say it as it's spelt. People always have trouble whenever they ask me my name. Say, for example, the Year 11 senior forum a little while back. And this is just a routine for me, though a little worse than some. I met Mrs. Brand before it started, and I told her my name. And from past experience, I emphasised the pronunciation, and I thought she understood. But, as some of you know, she obviously didn't, and after 4 attempts, all she came up with was salami salam. And for the next week, the only thing I heard was, hi salami, and it gets a bit boring after about 100 people say it to you twice, and your teachers mentioned something about it as well. And do you know when somebody's about to knock you, they always start off with your most obvious fault, or what happens to be unusual about yourself? Well, of course with me, it was, and still is, my name. I mean, I don't understand. Why do people think twisting my name is going to hurt me? It's happened to me all my life. And do you know what I'm thinking when somebody says this to me? I think, very original. Great comeback. Nobody's ever used that tactic on me before. Now this really brings back memories from primary school and all the creative versions people made for my name. Things like Salami Sailor, Sail the Seven Seas, and Sally Boobs. And today, not so long ago, Salabar. Now I have no idea where these originated from, but people seem to get their kicks out of calling me these names. I've had trouble with my name as far back as I can remember. For instance, when I was 4 and my brother was 3, he couldn't pronounce my name. So for some unknown reason, he called me Minna, which if some of you don't know, which is what my parents later named my sister. The next prominent memory is from when I went to Mittagong Primary School. And out of the whole 6 years of my life at that school, not once did the principal pronounce my name right. This is particularly bad because we used to have assemblies every month, and most people were bound to get an award at least every 2 to 3 months. And every time I got one, it was the same. He'd always say, Salama Salem, and I'd correct him, but after a while I just gave up. And here's a useless, uninteresting fact that you'll probably never use in your life again. My first name is a greeting in Arabic. It means peace, though it is pronounced as Salam. And here's another point, and as usual, a no-win situation. Whenever somebody asks me my name, they never get it right the first time. They always take 2 or 3 or more times to understand. So to prevent this from happening once, I said to them very slowly, Salama Salem. This way they understood, first go. But they got very offended and didn't like me much after that. So when you've all grown up and you've had children and you're deciding on names for them, just remember, if you give them something unusual or something hard to pronounce, this is just a taste of what they're likely to endure. And it's okay, really. Thank you.
A recurring headline, another suicide just before the HSCs. Always trying to be better was her motto. Stop at nothing was her last thought. Why? Because we have been brought up, trained, to be this person who no one can be or step over. If not from our parents, teachers, brothers or sisters, it's the constant competition between our friends and peers. We are always being judged. Didn't someone once say that all people are created equal? Yet, there are always people being placed above them. So many lives have been lost to peer pressure and the pressures of society today. For example, a group of students discussing how their grades are look down upon the others who are in lower classes. They may have the higher marks, but that's not what life's all about. They are being judged by their grades. People make up what they are like and how they act just by looking at them and what classes and levels they're in. What is it? What is
This is what has to be changed. Start recognising the people who really try and not just abuse their gift. People who put in their heart and soul into everything and try so hard just to be pushed aside by someone smarter to come along and burst their bubble. I think we should listen to them more as people, not just lower marks and grades. Give them a chance to show what they can do. I think you will be surprised. Why should they be ashamed of who they are? Whether you're in a high or a low class, you should be all treated equally. Many a time I've heard the words, "Aren't you embarrassed to be in a low class?" or, "I would be so depressed if I was in your class." Yeah, right, who's the one that's got the pressure to stay on top all the time? What makes them so superior they can talk to us like that? You'd be surprised to see how many of the so-called lower students beat the so-called high students in their exams lately. I wonder if people would just stop putting them down and give them a chance for once and give some encouragement, what would happen then? We have been brought up in this world to do one thing, to succeed at all costs, and this is what's killing the youth of today. Thank you.
Good afternoon, fellow human beings and teachers. I'm not going to excite you with any tales about the latest environmental issue. I'm going to tell you all about my parents. Alright, I'll start at the beginning. Shopping experiences I've had. It's the usual Sunday morning, I was in bed, and my little brother, who enjoys to drive CDs around the house, he pretends they're steering wheels, you know. Dip-doo-dip-doo, comes into my room, that's his blinker, puts on the brake. Amy, come on, get out of bed, we're going Wollongong. So I said, great. Scam something out of mum on this one. So I get dressed, get in the car, and we pull into Gardas R Us. And we walk around, and around. Mum says, "Oh, thank God, no, it's cute. That's such a pretty plant, isn't it? Look really nice next to the daisy, you know, kind of stuff." And I'm just thinking, buy it. And we come out with a bag of mushroom manure. Now, I don't even know mushrooms, you know. This brings me to another shopping experience. I don't know if it's your favourite place, but it's my favourite place. Auto Alley, Parramatta Road. So we pull into this place that's giving away free sausages and drinks. Mum wants his car, it's all the way out the back, and so they pull out every car in the place, and we take this car for a test drive, and his engine's got this whirring noise. The man's trying to talk over the top of it, and we're all sitting in the back of the car laughing at it. And anyway, 25 sausages, 4 drinks, and 3 very stupid looking car salesmen later, we bunny hopped down Parramatta Road in the same car we bunny hopped up in. Judging from these experiences, if your mum or dad ever asks you if you want to go to an auction or a furniture shop, just say no. No. That's something that's really boring with my parents, but there's an annoying part of my mum. It's when my brother's allowed to do it every once and I'm not. And I ask the question, why is he so? Because he's a boy and he can't get pregnant. I'm just going to go, no. There's a quite embarrassing little tale to tell about my mum, and that was when I was in the back gate, we were going to a blue light disco. So we pull up out the front of the Memorial Hall. Mum's in a bright yellow van, and she beeps a horn and she sticks her head out the window. Amy's here! We've all slid in the back of the car, it's me and a couple of my friends. And instead of, like, we're waiting for her to drive off and no one would know we got out of that car, but no, she sat there and waited till we got out of the car and beat the horn and she drove off waiting. We sort of died all through the disco because we're like, not me. Well, I suppose we're talking about my parents and my dad. He's like Homer Simpson. Sits on the couch, drinks beer, smokes cigarettes, has a high blood pressure. You know, blames it on his kids, but it's still his lifestyle. Eats a lot, quite fat. Complains about work. If you ask him how's work, he says it's still there. When I think about my parents, I think they're quite fun because, you know, there's never a dull moment in my house. Sitting at the dinner table is just a big laugh. We just hassle each other and that. And it's really cool. Just ask any of my friends. They've been there, sat at my table, just laughed at my parents. My mum's just a lunatic. I tend to follow in her footsteps. That's the end of my speech.
Thank you. Sarah Donaldson. And the topic is, it's enough to make your skin crawl.
The topic I'll be given is that it's enough to make your skin crawl. There are quite a few things that make my skin crawl, so I've taken the first thing that I thought of, and it happens at school. And it happens in that subject which I love so much, science. And yes, I'm talking about dissection. Whenever we did dissection, particularly in Mike's blood, Mr. Miller used to always say, "Oh, Sarah, don't be a girl," when I tried not to get into it. But it's not some sort of girlish thing, it's just that it just makes my stomach turn. My mother, who used to be a nurse, always says that she could watch open heart surgery while she was eating and not feel a thing. But the smell of those little bits of something that ran around not so long ago, and the way it sort of quivers on the tray, and those lovely little blood clots and stringy bits, and the bits that look a bit too much like I would probably look inside, it's enough to make my skin crawl.
Skin crawl. How many times have we heard this saying in our life? Many, I believe. But where did it come from and who started it? I mean, the fact skin crawling. Skin can't even walk. What makes people think it can crawl? A lot of people say that different things make their skin crawl. Such people think bugs make their skin crawl. They see a bug, they'll start screaming and say, "Ew," to make your skin crawl. Other people walking down the street see someone go, "Is enough to make your skin crawl." But really, what does it mean? So I really don't know, but I'm sure that there is somebody out there who knows what "it's enough to make your skin crawl" means.
Stuart, you go into the bathroom and you know how in females' toilets they've always got the baby's change table. There's always a lady in there with her son. She's changing his nappy. And they just do it. You know, no one else would do it in public. No female, only a male. Of course, it's really disgusting. It's enough to make your skin crawl when you see this baby just do it. It goes all over the wall. It is really revolting. And then you see the little kids just say, you're at McDonald's. You're sitting there and you're ready to eat. And you see these little kids, they've got dirt all over them because they've been out in playland. They come in, they've got dirt from one end of them to the other. They pick up their chips and go, "Do you want a chip? Do you want a chip?" to everyone in the restaurant. And you just think, oh, yuck. No one else would do it. But of course, it's kids. They always do it. Only kids, because they don't know how to behave in public. So you think that parents would actually tie them up and leave them in their bedroom. But no, of course not. They never do. It's just not worth it. But you never see the female kids doing this. And then they come and they suck on their fingers. They come and they wipe them down your leg. And you're starting to think by this time, well, I think I might leave now. I've had enough of these kids. But anyway, it is really enough to make your skin crawl. So next time you see a little boy, or sometimes even a little girl, run the other direction. Thanks. It's enough to make your skin crawl. A lady
with 15 snakes, lady with 27 snakes, 6 pythons, 7 red belly black snakes, 3 tiger snakes, and 1 blue belly black snake is enough to make skin crawl. This lady had all these snakes in her house, in cages, in the garage, everywhere, until these were given to her and got them. Spiderwebs, which is sticky, silky, and not knowing where the spider is, makes my skin crawl. People coming up behind you and scaring you. Or even when it's cold, shiver, it still makes your skin crawl. But the most thing is when you're standing up here, shaking for buttery, trying to talk for 2 minutes and make it interesting. Another thing is when you're in science and you have to bisect a lion's heart. You have to tear it in half and observe it and see where all its arteries are and and veins and all that stuff. And gross. Another thing. Oh.
Hay fever, it's enough to make my skin really crawl. In the morning when I wake up, you know how you're in that in-between stage where your alarm goes off and you just quickly turn it off so you hope, you know, you can get that extra 5 minutes of sleep before you have to race around? Well, this isn't possible for me because as soon as I wake up, I'm conscious that I have to breathe through my nose, and as soon as I do, it starts to tickle and I sneeze. But I don't sneeze once, I keep on going and going and going. And you never know how many muscles you use when you sneeze, it's amazing. The past gym class, I can really feel my stomach muscles go. Well, of course, I reach over, I get the tissue when I blow my nose. But hay fever isn't like a cold. You know how you can usually get all the congestion up and out of your body? Not with hay fever. You sneeze, you blow it out. You sneeze, you blow it out. It doesn't stop. It's a continuous cycle. One way my brother likes to get rid of it is to hag or spag, or as the older generations call it, maybe to spittoon. I find it really disgusting. I don't understand. I ask him, why do you have to do it? Well, I've got to get it out of my mouth. Yeah, but I don't understand, why does he have to spit right where I'm just about to walk? Another concept of hay fever is itchy eyes. This is really annoying for me because I have contacts and I can't rub them. I have to just squeeze, you know, really just inside there, and it doesn't work. And I always run out of tissues or hankies whenever I come to school. I always bring two hankies now because I found that one just isn't enough. Lately, I've found two isn't either. And if you've had any experience with coming to school and not being able to get a tissue anywhere, you use the school toilet paper. And boy, does it hurt your nose. Another thing is the pressure building up in your nose when you can't blow out because your nose gets blocked. This is sometimes called a sinus headache. I've gone to the doctor for this because it really got bad and it just, well, the pain was unbearable, believe it or not. He gave me, I think some other people might have had, you squeeze something up your nose and it's liquid and maybe you're supposed to put your head back. But it doesn't work, you come back down and it dribbles straight. I told the doctor this, so he gave me something else. It was like a Ventolin, though smaller, and you put it up your nose. You sprayed it, and I can't explain the feeling. It's like, you know when you do a somersault in a chlorine pool and it goes all up your nose? It was like that. Another is, and when you have go to sleep with this blocked nose, you wake up in the morning, and as you get to breathe through your mouth all night, it's all dry and slimy. And you wake up and it's sort of dried a little bit there sometimes. It tastes disgusting. Let me tell you. Now for those of you who don't suffer this, just think it's like having a constant cold. I have to suffer for this for 3 months of the whole year. Thank God for Demizen. Thank you very much.
Have you ever woken up and just look above you and there's a spider just sitting right above you on the wall? It just makes my skin crawl. And you turn around and just everywhere. They're just hanging around everywhere. They never go away. You spray them, they just run under somewhere else, and then you've got to worry about whenever they're going to come out or not. One thing that makes my skin crawl is when you go down the road and you sort of see animals sort of everywhere all over the road and sort of run over them and think, oh God, that's going to stick to my tire for a while. Another thing that makes my skin crawl is scary dreams. When you wake up and you don't know what's happened, you sort of just got to put yourself back where you are. And one dream I always had was I was swimming along and Jaws would be behind me coming along. And as soon as he'd go to bit me, I'd wake up and then I'd go back sleeping and I had the same dream again. And another thing that makes my skin crawl is when people constantly think it's really funny to run their fingernails down a blackboard and it just feels like you've got no backbone. Other scary dreams are when you wake up and you're in a bed full of snakes and you just don't know what to do. Or you're bushwalking along and you think a snake's bitten you and you're just packing it out and you have a look down and it's just not there anymore. And you just go delusional. And that's it.
That's the Amy Allen.
As you all know, because six people already speaking before me, the topic is it's enough to make your skin crawl. What is that? Skin crawl. Skin crawl or I don't know. I think it's when you get that feeling inside you where you shiver and or you feel like you're gonna throw up and you feel really gross and numb and tense up. You know, like when you've just been summoned to Miss Erskine's office. Personally, what makes my skin crawl is watching people brush their teeth. The spit sprays on the mirror. Disgusting, you hear the bristles going, all the spit in their mouth and the bits of food coming out of their teeth. Oh, disgusting. I had a conversation with a couple of people and we were talking about food and we came to Chinese food and that makes my skin crawl. One of my dad's next door neighbour, she was in hospital and when she had a baby they asked her for the placenta, the afterbirth. A Chinese person wanted it for their restaurant because they cook it and they serve it. You mean going to a restaurant? Order a placenta sandwich or something.
Yeah.
There's lots of common things that just make your skin crawl, like the nails down the board, things like that. One of the worst experiences I've ever had was one night. I just brush my teeth, get into bed, and I'm about to fall asleep, and I feel this thing crawling up next to my head, and I'm nearly wet myself. And it was my brother, he got under my bed, and he's crawled his hand up to my face, and it's gone up my head, and oh, I nearly died. Oh, it killed me. I think it saw my skin crawls the night before a competition or something. When I see gymnastics competitions or athletics come, it's like when you're lying in bed thinking of whether you're going to win or whether you're not going to win. It pretty much makes my skin crawl knowing that I'm running for vice captain because it's pretty scary stuff. Yeah, there's all different kinds of skin crawling. That completes my speech.
Ladies and gentlemen, keep it very brief. The standard of all the speeches were quite pleasing. The confident manner of many of the speakers is very pleasing to see in ones so young. And especially, I think this is the first competition I've seen where the impromptus have been of a fairly high standard, where people can actually talk for some considerable period of time, rather than going, yeah, yeah, so basically, many of the speakers were polished, many of them were quite substantial in terms of their subject matter and so on, but upon deliberation, Simmons and myself have given the competition to Sarah Donaldson, and with Salva coming a very increasingly nearer second as the impromptus went on. So Sarah, congratulations Sarah, and congratulations to Salva. Thank you.